ain't no place harder that I ain't played music. I can still play a lot of old-time popper tunes, you know. Music's good for you. I really do. In different ways. I mean, it's been mighty good for me. I believe it's been good for my health. I sure do. May keep you out of meanness, too. Ain't that right? Might keep you out of meanness.
I want to bring out an amazing performer here who's, life, as I mentioned, has kept pace with the 20th century, and who's seen every bit of it. He's lived in East Tennessee ever since he was born in 1900 in Sequatchie College, Tennessee. He started playing music when he was 17 with his father and cousin. They played square dances in their area. They walked up and down the mountains for 2-3 weeks at a time, playing along the way. Wanted to be a fiddler, but his father discouraged him. Didn't think you could make money doing that. But finally, when he was 28 years old, his father gave him his fiddle and told him to go ahead and play. He's played with musicians who, some of you who study country music, know as legendary names, Low Stokes and Clayton McMitchin. He hired the Louvin Brothers when they were still in their teens. Please welcome 99 years old, Mr. Bob Douglas, on our show.
I want to say howdy to everybody. How are you, sir?
How are you?
Well, I'm still hanging around. Yeah. 5 minutes. Don't take off here. Hello, everybody. How are you doing?
Hey, doing good. Bob, how you doing, buddy?
Well, I'm still hopping around.
Just about ready to have a birthday, aren't you?
Well, yeah, this is my birthday.
Come here, I'm saving your chair for you, buddy.
No, I don't want to sit down.
Sit down, that's
it. I don't sit down. We're just taking some pictures.
You got your fiddle with you?
It's over at the house.
Let me see your hand there, buddy. Well, I've got an old fiddle back there in the back.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not much. Probably not as good as one you play.
I fell at the house, Tom.
You fell?
Here a while back.
And, good.
Hit this side here and injured it. Mm-hmm. It's still sore in there. And I hit this hand again something or other, and it sprung it or something or other.
You're going to feel good enough to go to your birthday party, aren't you?
I'm going to try.
Okay.
Sure enough.
I'm Uncle Bob Barber there, Tom.
Who knew?
I heard about that.
I wanted to make him look pretty.
Yeah.
He told me he wouldn't let anybody else cut his hair but you.
I'm gonna need a hair trim pretty soon. Boys, this is Tom Morgan. My good friend lives out on the mountain.
Uh-huh.
Tom Morgan, these boys lives in Knoxville.
Do they really?
Yeah.
They treated you pretty good in Knoxville.
Oh, they're fine boys, I'm telling you. We've been making a video.
You're going to be a movie star, aren't you?
Uncle Bob, are they going to release that video or is he going to have to escape?
Yeah, I reckon it'll be released on it.
Some people feel like the great traditional musicians, especially in Tennessee, were musicians who had the ability to synthesize a number of other musics and bring them together into something new. This is basically what Elvis Presley did. This is basically what W.C. Handy did. And this is what Bob Douglas is doing. If you look at the music that he was exposed to growing up, and look at the area around Chattanooga, it's such a wonderful crossroads of different musical styles. You do have the old-time mountain fiddling, to be sure, but you also have the commercial country music scene. You have the old-time medicine shows. You have the African-American music of the musicians that played on the riverboat, the coal miners who worked in the mines. And all of this music comes together in the Chattanooga area into a wonderful, complicated, heady sort of burgoo. And Bob was right in the middle of all of that. And he was one of those people who took a little from this and a little from that and melded them together and created the kind of wonderful fiddle music that he represents today.
A lot of Deborah Bowen in that. Old hen cackle. I used to play the fool out of that.
Oh, you did.
I can't do it.
Okay.
Now there's a lot of double. A lot of stuff like that, you know. And this arm don't work anymore. I can't fiddle like that no more. Always comes a time, you know. Always comes time. Gotta go long as he can. I thank the Lord that he's let me go and play like I do, you know. Of course, they just ain't no people as old as I am can play fiddles, you know that, or any kind of instrument as far as that goes. It'd be hard to find a fiddle player play the fiddle like I do at 99 years old. But I'm still hanging on.
Bob, you don't want to even play just a little sketch of that just for history, Bob. They don't have to use it. No one will ever see it but us.
I can't play it, Paul.
For Nellie.
I'd been around some good fiddle players before I met Bob, not too long ago when I had the pleasure of sitting in with him and a couple of three other guys at the Mountain Opry up at Signal Mountain. He was so close to what he was in the early 40s that it scared me how he could how his finger could still operate. And his bow hand, he still has it. And you don't use the words, the old boy plays pretty good fiddle to be 100 years old. He just plays good fiddle, period. And I hope he lives to be 150, and I'm one of his pallbearers when he leaves.
Well,
we're going to do a little old tune called Memphis Blues now.
Timer said that the fiddle was the devil's box.
Yeah.
You ever heard that?
Yeah, I've heard it.
So what's your take on that?
I don't go for that. No. That ain't so about fiddle. I don't think that of a fiddle. I think a fiddle is a wonderful instrument, and they just anybody can't pick up one and start playing it. It takes a lot of work to learn to play a fiddle. Now, you can learn to play a guitar right quick, but you can't do that with a fiddle. It takes a lot of practice. I like any music played on a fiddle. And there's another thing that I got to give them guitar players and singers, you notice all of them, everybody's got a guitar. There's piles and piles of guitars. Everybody's got a guitar. Why don't some of them learn some fiddles or something other else play? Ain't that what you think? Huh?
Thank you.
either the hire and do the talking or the announcer when we was on the radio, because Bob didn't have a whole lot to say. Tell me what you want me to play, or tell me when it's my time and I'll go. He just loved to play the fiddle, and he didn't mess with that singing. That was too hard for him, he said.
We're going to play an old Jess Young breakdown tune here that he used to play all the time. Bobby, what's his name? It?
Oh, my Lord.
Oh, my Lord. I don't know where he got that or what, but he used to play that all the time. We're going to try to play a little of it. Bobby, I used to. I was like my dad. Dad, fella come in there one night, we was playing for days out in the mountains. Said, Mr. Douglas, said, would you like to have a little drink? Yeah, I believe I will, he said. So he went out and took a little drink. When he done that, I saw him on his fiddle. He come back in after a while, a little while longer, after he played another set, why, fella come back and said, Mr. Douglas, you want another drink? Nope, done had one. He never would take but one drink. Well, that's the way I am. I used to, I'd take a drink, this one drink. But everybody's not like that, you know. They get one drink, they want two. It's all the drink. It's all right to take a drink if you just don't make a fool out of yourself. Just take your drink and quit. Ain't nothing wrong with that. But I, like I say, I didn't really love whiskey. But I do love beer. I love the taste of beer. Liberty at the Corn Liquor Still in Georgia. If I can think, I go. Thank you.
Bob Douglas, of course, is a national treasure. I first met Bob Douglas when we were playing over the radio in Chattanooga. He was, you know, the fiddle player of the Chattanooga area. He won contests all over and played with some rather famous musicians all around. He was always a gentleman. He would show youngsters like me his tunes. For example, he taught me to play Muddy Road to Ducktown. And if you were interviewing Bob Douglas and he's 99 or 100, ask him if he can still play Muddy Road to Ducktown, and he probably can.
Hey, that there's a tune that I got a little story behind. You want to hear it? Huh? Well, there's one man in Chattanooga, you probably heard of him. His name was, they called him Sawmill Tom. You ever heard of Sawmill Tom Smith? Okay, that's the man I'm talking about. He's the only one that played this tune. And I wanted to learn it so bad. He lived up in the holler out of Chattanooga, one of them hollers down there. And he lived at a log, big old log house with a long porch, you know, the side of it. I went up there and I had a little old tape recorder, took it with me. I wanted to get it on tape if I could. And I went up there and Tom was sitting out on the porch filing a handsaw. And he just barely could move. He had cancer so bad, you know. And so I got after him to put this here tune, Muddy Road to Ducktown. I got after him to put that on the tape for me. And he said, Bob says, I can't play fiddle anymore. I can't work the bow. So I kept talking to him, and he finally told his wife, said, bring my fiddle out here. She went in the house and got his fiddle brought out on the porch. He took the bow and got on to it, but he couldn't do nothing with it much, but he did put enough of it on there that I learned Muddy Road to Ducktown. Okay. He said, Bob says, you want to know the history of Muddy Road to Ducktown? Said, I'll tell you that too. So he did. He said, said back in the war days, a bunch of soldiers was building this road from out of Georgia to Ducktown. I think it's a very short road, you know. And said that road was filthy muddy, buddy. And said they was having a dance on Saturday night. And so somebody played that tune and everybody wanted to know the title of it. Well, nobody didn't know it. And one man says, why not call it Muddy Road to Ducktown? So that's what they named it, Muddy Road to Ducktown. Now, he wasn't lying about that because the old man was dying. He's telling the truth about it. And he said, that's the truth about it. And he said, these soldiers named that tune the Muddy Road to Ducktown. And the road's still there now. And it comes out of Georgia, you know, short road to Ducktown. And said it was awful muddy. So he put me enough of that tune on my little tape that I learned it. Muddy Road to Ducktown. That's the name of it. And that's the history of it, too.
During Bob Duckley's prime years, he was a contest winner. He could take an audience and they would go crazy. I don't know how he did it. He was a good fiddle player, of course, but he still is a showman. But there was a subtle approach that he had. He could sell himself and his fiddle and his music as well as any fiddle player I've ever seen.
Bob Douglas and I played on radio station WDXB in Chattanooga, Tennessee during the 1940s. And at that time, I was a teenager, and Bob was a man. You know, I guess you were getting on up there then, weren't you?
I've always been old.
Bob Douglas played all the old tunes. He had what I would characterize as a soft stroke bow. Played all the old-time tunes, some difficult ones, Durang's hornpipe, all that stuff. He could note that very accurately. Probably still can.
Durang's hornpipe. Monday morning blues.
Tell them about it. Thank you.
tune here that we're going to finish up with is was put together with me and my dad over in Sequatchie Valley. I forget just what year it was in. I believe maybe it was in about the 30s, And we put together this Sequatchie Valley tune. So we're going to try to play a little of it. I can't hardly play it anymore. We got it on record, but that was a long time ago.
We appreciate y'all letting us join you tonight. I'm amazed every time I get to see Bob Douglas play the fiddle. Sequatchie Valley is one of the most beautiful places in the state of Tennessee, and I believe this is one of the best tunes that's ever been written in the state.
We'll try it, boys.
Back up here, Brother Bob Douglas. He's got fresh rosin on his bow, and he's going to fog up the whole room. It's a little bit of Monday morning rag. Bob, let's go.
When radio first came to Tennessee, Bob Douglas was ready for it. He fiddled on the air in 1925, which was the same year that the Grand Ole Opry had its first broadcast. By 1928, Bob had won the All-Southern Fiddling Championship, competing against the best known players of that era, and he went to Atlanta that year, recorded for RCA Victor. Through the 1930s, Bob was barnstorming across the country with great fiddlers like Clayton McMichin, Curly Fox, Carl Cotner. He played on the radio practically every day from the late 1930s through the 1950s in Chattanooga. And at age 75, he amazed everyone. He traveled to Washington, D.C., won the Smithsonian Institution's National Fiddle Contest and kept winning fiddle contests right up to 1989. And now at age 100, he's been invited to play on a Grand Ole Opry, one more radio broadcast added to the thousands that he's done. A lot of the Grand Ole Opry musicians know of Bob Douglas. His name is not with theirs in the Country Music Hall of Fame, but he's good enough at age 100 to play the Grand Ole Opry, and that's never been done before. And that's a tremendous achievement.
You want me to get your stuff for you?
Huh?
You want me to get your stuff for you?
Yeah. I ain't hardly ready yet.
Well, you better get a wiggle on.
Nellie, did you think Bob would ever make it down to the Opry?
Well, I didn't know. I've asked him many a time why he didn't ever go, but they asked him once to play over there.
Uh-huh.
He went over there, he was over there once, and he sold June and Johnny Cash a guitar.
Got my jacket?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm ready.
All you like is your fiddle.
You want me to get your fiddle?
Buster?
Yeah.
Hold down things. See you later.
Okay, Bob.
I'll be over there after a while.
Huh?
I'll be over there after a while.
You
when
will.
Jenny gets off,
Okay. Okay, though.
I think at any time during that, if we look over and Mr. Douglas is taking it, we should stand back.
Just stand back.
That's right.
And listen.
Right.
And learn.
I always thought that he sort of shunned the Grand Ole Opry, because I know that he's had chances to play over the Grand Ole Opry, but I don't think that was ever his really, really biggie ambition. And it really surprised me at 100 years old to hear that he was going to play at the Grand Ole Opry. Not that it's, he didn't have the ability to do it. It's just it's surprising that they would invite him to come over there and do it, you know.
Look at here.
I say. How you doing, Mr. Bob?
Oh, all right. How are you?
Oh, this is great, man. Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
This is going to be your night, brother. You're going to tear the house down, I know.
What?
You're going to do it for us.
Tear the house down?
Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah.
Watch your back.
I'm anxious to hear you tonight.
You're going to play that tonight, aren't you?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to listen.
Well,
I'm going to listen, okay? I'll be out there listening.
Okay.
Good to see you. Stuart Duncan. Stuart Duncan. Good to see you.
Stuart Duncan.
Stuart Duncan.
Bob Duncan. Glad to know you.
Enjoy your playing. I heard you a couple of years ago, too, on the radio.
Anyhow, we're going to. This is old time February's night. Bob Douglas on the show tonight. We're
going to
talk a little bit about
blind age. Tell him just a little bit, Bob. You tell him where you were born and when you were born. And then bust down on Muddy Road to Ducktown.
And then, ladies and gentlemen, this gentleman has had association with some of those string bands I was just talking about. He also played with the Louvin Brothers quite a bit. But he has never played on the Grand Ole Opry. And tonight we're going to correct that. This is his debut performance on the Grand Ole Opry as well. His name is Bob Douglas, 100 years old, ladies and gentlemen. Take it away, gentlemen. 102 months, he says. Nice to have you here, Mr. Douglas.
Well,
Now, we're not through with Mr. Douglas, however. Now, I mean, you know, when a gentleman who's 100 years old and 2 months shows up at the Grand Ole Opry, we think we ought to let him play just a little bit more, you know, especially since this is his debut, right? So they're getting all set up, and Mr. Bob is going to favor us with another number. Mr. Douglas, have at it, sir.
Are we going to play an old tune called Muddy Road to Ducktown? I mean, I'm going to try to play it.
You got one more you want to do?
Yes.
Why not, huh? You bet.
This tune that I'm going to do here is a blues. I call it the Monday Morning Blues. I made it up back in the 30s.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you, Mr. Douglas. We appreciate you being with us. A standing ovation here at the Friday Night Opry for 100-year-old Mr. Bob Douglas making his debut here at the Grand Ole Opry. Thank you, Mr. Douglas.
You know, the first person that really appeared on the Grand Ole Opry, the person that's given credit for starting the Grand Ole Opry, was an old-time fiddler, Uncle Jimmy Thompson. And a great deal is made out of this white-bearded old patriarch creaking up to the microphone and fiddling away into the night. And yet, when you really look at it, Uncle Jimmy Thompson was only 78 when he took to the microphone. But in this case, Bob is an extra 22 years older than Uncle Jimmy Thompson when he started the Grand Ole Opry. The Opry has had a large number of good senior old-time fiddlers, but in many cases, I can't think of anybody who even approaches 100 years old being on the show. I know there are a bunch of older fiddlers on there, but as far as I can tell from my own research, nobody was that age when they actually appeared on the Opry. And not only appeared on the Opry, because Bob's appearance was not a case of them bringing him out for a sort of token bow and maybe squeaking a tune or two. He got on there and he kicked butt. He played fiddle. He did a great job on the Opry. And that's the thing you have to remember, is that not only was he on the Opry at the age of 100, but he did the Opry proud at the age of 100. He reminded them and reminded everybody that the archetypal music of the Grand Ole Opry is fiddle music.
Bob's 100 years old now, and he needs help from time to time. He knows it. Bob's still independent. He doesn't relish the fact that he's got to look for folks to help him do things that he could do for himself a few years ago, but he puts up with it with good humor and a joke. He has got an attitude toward life and a passion that lets him pick up the fiddle and play, though his hands may hurt, or joke around with the nurses and doctors, even though they're putting him through some pain. He's makes the best of his situation, whatever it is, and I don't think there have been many people that have dealt with life as well as Bob Douglas has.
Car a little bit high off the ground there.
There you go, Chattanooga.
Yeah.
Let's go down there and look around.
Okay. I'm gonna get my toenails cut off.
Yeah. Yeah, that's all right. We'll do that.
I tell you, when your toenails gets too long, makes your feet hurt, you know. Me and Slim played a few tunes. Uh-huh. He used to play with me way back in, you know. Well, here, Slim. How you doing, old boy?
Well, you're the same old Bob, aren't you?
Huh?
You're the same old Bob, aren't you?
Yeah, same old Bob. Got to go down and have my toenails cut off.
You know. For real?
You know.
Well, that'd make me a good pick, wouldn't it?
Who's the most famous person you've ever worked on?
Well, you're right up there, but the most famous that I can recall is Andre the Giant. He had an ingrown toenail too.
He did.
Yeah.
So good now.
I can't believe you're smiling after having your toenails cut off.
I hope y'all have a nice time today. And I sure enjoyed your company. I enjoyed everything about it. And I'm proud that I can play a little bit.